I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show. Ben Macintyre. His new book is The Spy and the Traitor, the greatest espionage story of the Cold War. The spy is Oleg Gordievsky, a KGB officer who will leave the KGB service as a colonel. I think we all can think of a colonel in the KGB who left service and is with us today. So Gordievsky is also with us. In 1978, he's beckoned back to Moscow, to center, to the monastery, the KGB headquarters, the first chief directorate. This runs all of the dangerous business. He takes time to learn English and goes silent entirely. There's no contact for 1, 2, 3 years with MI6 until he approaches a Danish diplomat at a reception in London. And how does he do it?
Well, it was Oleg's way of sending a very subtle message back to the West that he was in business. They met at a cocktail party, and Oleg apparently casually told this Danish diplomat, I've been learning English. Now, when that piece of information was relayed back to London, that was a signal to London that he was on the trail and that he was trying to get into the all-important British department of the KGB. Because once he was in there, they realized he would be likely to be sent to London and they could crack open the Crown Jewels.
His boss doesn't want him to go.
His
boss doesn't want somebody to poach him, but he's got the English, the German, the Danish, the Russian. He's the son of a KGB hero. He's the brother of a KGB hero, now dead at 39 of alcohol. Vasily's gone. He's a perfect person to send to London, but eventually it will happen because they're openings.
Yeah, that's right. And he manages to maneuver. It's very subtle the way he did it. He managed to maneuver his way until really he was the only candidate they could possibly send. Although they said, look, we don't think it's going to work because the Brits must know he's a KGB officer and they might not bring him in. It worked, though. I mean, he managed to get himself sent to London, but before going, he went through the British files of the KGB, and with this prodigious memory, he tried to memorize as much as he possibly could. Now, you mentioned Michael Foot earlier. The biggest file in the British archives of the KGB was one labeled Agent Boot. Now, Agent Boot was Michael Foot, and what these files revealed was that Foot had met not just a few times, but dozens of times with KGB officers. He'd been paid a very substantial amount of money, and he had been passing on useful information until 1968. Now, what made this gold dust for Britain was the fact that Michael Foot had now risen to the head of the Labour Party and was about, as you said, to go into battle against Margaret Thatcher. There was a decent chance that the next Prime Minister of Britain was going to be a paid KGB informant.
Ben, it's spectacular. It's breathtaking. You understand we're in America living through a plot not dissimilar, not proved the way Gordievsky proved Foot, for heaven's sakes. And there are things that Foot could have said. I never gave them secrets because I didn't have any. But for heaven's sakes.
Yeah. It looked horrible. And MI6 was presented with a real problem because it was so explosive, this piece of information, that they knew that if it got into the press, if it got into the wrong hands, if it got into the hands of politicians, particularly politicians on the right, Michael Foot's career would be destroyed.
It's still explosive. It got into the hands of an historian, and it's still explosive.
Well, you're right, actually, Don. I mean, when this news broke in Britain a few weeks ago, it created a firestorm because to the left, Michael Foot is still this venerated, revered figure. To the right, he's a kind of hate figure. The right said, this proves he's a traitor. The left said, this is an unconscionable smear against an innocent
man.
What
does Corbyn say?
Corbyn said that. Corbyn went on Twitter immediately to start attacking the idea without, I think, having bothered to read the book. The truth is that the answer is in the middle there. I mean, Michael Foot was not a spy as we would understand it. Nor was he a kind of completely pure, innocent figure. He was passing on information. He was taking money.
And taking money.
I mean, the money is the critical
thing. And he was a very sophisticated person. He knew the Cambridge Five. He knew how dangerous this was. He knew how the Soviets had penetrated all aspects of the Foreign Office. He knew all of that.
He knew all of that, and yet I think he behaved incredibly naively. There's a very good Russian phrase, which literally means useful idiot. It was coined by Lenin himself, and it's somebody who either advertently or inadvertently is used by the Soviets to push a certain line. I think Michael Foot fits into the category of useful idiot, and there are others around today.
We're having too much fun, Ben, but how can we help ourselves? Before we go to the traitor, Pimlico is the operation that's created when Gordievsky goes back to Moscow, and it's kept on the shelf all those years later until it's used. What is Pimlico?
Operation Pimlico was the escape plan. Oleg, before he even went back to Moscow, said to his handlers, his MI6 handlers, you need to have some sort of system for getting me out of here. If I get into trouble, how can I get out? Now, nobody had ever escaped from the Soviet Union before. It was a huge prison. And so it was very difficult, but there was one loophole, which was that diplomatic cars theoretically could pass through borders without being searched. So that was a potential way of getting Oleg out. If they could get him into the boot of a car, of a diplomatic car with diplomatic plates, they might get him out through Finland. But he had to be able to send a signal. And the signal, believe it or not, went like this. The signal sounds as if it comes straight from John le Carré. And yes. It went like this. Yes. If Oleg Gordievsky was seen on a Tuesday evening at 7:30 on a particular corner of a particular street outside a bread shop in Moscow holding a plastic Safeways bag from the supermarket, that was the sign that he needed to get out. And the acceptance signal that the Brits had to give him was that an MI6 officer had to walk past him holding a Harrods bag and eating either a Mars bar or a Kit Kat.
It is a wonderful detail in Ben's book that the MI6 officers who exercise eventually Pimlico cannot look at a Kit Kat ever again.
That's right.
They've sworn them off in their lives.
Honestly, they used to wander around with their pockets full of Kit Kats.
Years
just in
of
case.
Going there on Tuesdays, thinking, watching on Tuesdays.
And
with
years
Kit
is
Kat.
Right, John. Years is right, because right. For 7 years, every Tuesday, somebody had to police that signal site, whether or not Oleg was in town, because they couldn't change the pattern of their behavior because they too were under surveillance. So if they only checked the signal site when Oleg was there in Moscow, that would be a signal that something was up.
London. The resident, the boss spy, is a man, a wonderful man named Guck.
No, you couldn't make that up, could you?
Guck, who drives around in a cream-colored Mercedes.
Yep.
These people don't read spy novels.
I know, he's straight out of Central Casting,
what,
isn't he?
What? And that's the boss. And the whole atmosphere of the London embassy is paranoia. It's a mini Stalinist state.
Yeah.
And Gordievsky has to prosper in this. Meanwhile, Leila and the now two daughters are prospering living in London. They're all there together, and Gordievsky at the safe house, he's got another handler, a safe house prepared by MI6 with the wonderful Veronica Price. Gosh, Ben, if you didn't make this stuff up. Preparing neat little cucumber sandwiches for the days of the meetings. And of course, they're drinking tea, but because he's Russian, he wasn't a drinker. Does he become a drinker those years in London?
Not really in London. Later on. When he's
so,
under huge
So he's not
stress.
Drinking or smoking at this point.
No.
The MI6 are, but not he. All right. He's giving them enormously good information all the time. But the MI6 won't share it. Why not?
Because, well, lots of reasons, really. One, it's too good. It's too good. If you start to share all this information with all your allies, you start to threaten your own source.
Especially the CIA.
Well, exactly. And this is where we get into the crux of it. Increasingly, during the early 80s, the product was so good. I mean, this operational download was the biggest they'd ever had, MI6. They began to pass it on to the CIA. But they passed it on in disguise. They would never reveal who the source was. Now, that's traditional tradecraft. You normally don't reveal the identity of your source. You can say that it's good information, but you don't have to say where it comes from.
But you have a source, and the CIA will not rest until it knows what it is.
Well, the CIA doesn't like not to know where information comes from. And it's a tricky look. I mean, if you're going into the Oval Office and saying, Mr. President, this is very good information, but we don't really know where it comes from, the CIA doesn't really like that.
The Gordievsky risk at this point is atomic. But he's in London. And as you read along, you think, okay, stay there. Don't do anything. Keep passing the secrets on. He memorizes things. He gives names, documents. It's a complete penetration of the KGB. What's important is what he teaches is not true. What is not true is that the KGB and the Soviet state that supports it is competent. That is not true. And I'm amazed, Ben, that we didn't know that at the time, but it's apparent that that was news to Washington and London.
Yes. I mean, what he was able to tell Washington and London was that the KGB was not this 10-foot monster, that it was corrupt, it was bloated, it was inefficient, it wasn't working very well. And more to the point, it hadn't riddled the West with thousands of spies as they were expecting. And this imbued both the CIA and MI6 with considerable confidence. He also cracked open what is probably the biggest secret of the time, which was that the Andropov regime in Moscow genuinely believed that Ronald Reagan was going to press the button on a nuclear first
strike. Right, this is Operation Ryan, which is a Russian acronym for rockets are going to land on us. Yes.
Yep.
and they believed it. Andropov takes, Brezhnev dies. Brezhnev grows the first chief directorate from 3,000 to 10,000. This is all Ben's wonderful reporting. So it's bloated. It has officers that are not well-trained. Gordievsky he's one of us. He's family. He's a superior officer. He's had training. He has many languages. But there are a lot of characters who are not anywhere competent. They're searching. It's fantastic to report, but we've read Ryan elsewhere. They're searching for blood banks to see if they're increasing their storage in the event of a nuclear war. They're going to churches to see if there's more attendance by the elite in Washington because they know a war is coming. Mm. They're looking at parking lots. It's fantastic. What does Gordievsky make of all this?
Well, he's actually, I mean, at the time, he couldn't quite believe it. I mean, he
neither can I today.
Well, quite a lot of KGB officers were kind of thinking, my goodness, they really think this is going to happen. I mean, you mentioned the blood banks. I mean, one of the ironic things about the blood banks is that the KGB in Moscow believed that a blood bank was actually a sort of bank, and that therefore if the price of blood went up, that would mean that there was about to be a nuclear strike. Of course, blood doesn't have a price, you just donate it, but they hadn't worked that out. I mean, some of it is comical, but at the center of it was a very sinister point, which was that as Reagan was talking about the evil empire, the brutality of the Soviet Union, that was being interpreted in Moscow as a prelude to an attack. Now, when Reagan and Thatcher discovered through Gordievsky what the Kremlin was really thinking, it had a dramatic effect on the rhetoric. Reagan deliberately began to tone it down, and you can really see the beginning of the end of the Cold War.
You can, and you can see it from the point of view of Gordievsky, who's in London watching this. But these were bad months, late 83, early 84. Andropov dies of kidney failure in February of 84, and Chernenko, who's even more dead-looking than
Andropov. Totally moribund, yeah.
Yes, the corpse looks more alive than Chernenko, and I think Margaret Thatcher sees that.
Yes, she was appalled
wonderful detail. Gordievsky tells Margaret Thatcher how to dress for Andropov's funeral. When we come back, Ben Macintyre, the spy and the traitor, the greatest espionage story of the Cold War with fashion. I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show.